This is going to sound like a repetitive question. Throughout any time in your career, have you pulled pranks on anybody or the victim of any pranks?
I'll let me think about that one. I can't remember right now. Okay, next.
I just finished IQ not too long ago. Given your admittedly spotty relationship with words, was that very hard for you? Would you consider doing it again? And how much of that was actually your voice?
In what?
IQ, the book you co-wrote with Peter David.
Did I read that?
I read it. I don't know why you.
Did I read an audio of that?
No, you wrote it apparently.
No, I did write it, but I'm asking, I think I do. So when you're saying how much of it was my voice, you don't mean literally my voice.
I mean when you were during the writing.
I wrote all of the first person part of IQ. In other words, all the stuff that had to do with IQ, with Q going, wow, this makes me think of, and you know, blah, blah, blah. Those were all mine. And Peter, when we got together, I said to Peter, I could no more write a Star Trek novel than fly to the moon. And he said, don't you worry, I know all of the characters and all of the this and all of that. And we found sort of this hand-in-glove way of working in which I took care of all my stuff and he did everything else.
Yes.
Yes.
Next.
Hi. This is a question about stage work. And you know, people probably ask what show would you really like to do, but my question is, either as a director or actor, what bit of stage work would you just jump at the bit for?
You mean like what play would I like
to do? Yeah, play or opera, either.
Oh, I don't know. They don't come very, they don't come that way in which I get to go and say. I'll tell you the ones in which I have done, which I really enjoyed. I did art maybe 5 or 6 years ago, or whatever. Man and Superman was a big one for me, along with the Don Bond section. Child of Byron, I loved. I don't think in those terms. I never have thought in those terms. I have a very close friend of mine who is a wonderful, wonderful actor, who actually has a list of all the plays that he wanted to have been in, and he's just ticking them off. I just never thought that way. But then again, he only acts. And so when I have downtime, I immediately move over to another project. Oh, I'll give you this sort of silly and really useful way. When I was on the soap, somebody asked me about it. I talked to the person who created the soap. Corday, his name was. His son now runs the soap, but I forget what his name was. He was an elderly, Ted Corday. He was an elderly gentleman at the time. And the soap had started out as a radio show, and then it became a television show. I said, how in the world do you keep all of these stories? He said, well, what I would do is that I would roll out, I don't think he meant this literally, but these are the words he said. I would roll out a whole roll of toilet paper. I thought, we're already in the interesting territory. He said, I would have 3 rolls of toilet paper, and I would roll them out. One was storyline A, B, and C. I would write the entire story for a year on A, B, and C. I'd roll it back up, and then on that particular, the next day, you know, I would take 2 sheets of A, 4 sheets of B, 1 sheet of C. I thought, oh, that's pretty interesting. And then I began thinking, you know what? This could work for my life. Directing, acting, writing. I could do the same thing. So if I've pulled out 4 sheets of A, acting, and acting isn't happening tomorrow, well, I could just go to B. And so that's how I've sort of worked it for the last 25 years. So I've always had my toilet paper to go to. 10 minutes.
Excellent. I just read in the program that you went to Kent State. I was wondering if you were there during the incident with the National Guard. Yes.
Yes, I was.
Do you have a story about that? Was it?
Well, really quickly, because it's a long story. Yes, I was there, and I was, as I said to people, I was no further away than that camera there in the middle of the room when the shooting started, and I ended up a couple of days later going on the march in Washington. And when I was on the march in Washington, there were, I don't know, whatever, many hundreds of thousands, and I was walking there, and I thought, you know, I am simply just one person in here, and I don't think I'm having the effect that I want to have. And I went to the phone book, and I looked up Senator Young's phone number and his house listed in the phone book, in the white paper. And I went over to his house and I knocked on his door, and somebody answered, it wasn't him. I said who I was. He comes to the door, and I explained who I was, and he invited me in. And he sat me down, and I said, I'd like to tell you what happened at Kent, and I'd like to tell it to you from my point of view, before you hear all sorts of spin. So he offered me a drink, and I remember it was a beautiful, one of those wonderful glass tumblers. He said, what do you drink? I said, bourbon. So he gave me a nice big bourbon. He listened to my story and he said, I want you to meet Ted Kennedy. You need to tell him this story. He said, however, young man, I need to get you a white shirt. Because I guess I did not look, I looked too much the part. So he got me a white shirt. Gave me a white shirt. He took me over to the Senate, and I met Ted Kennedy, and I told him my story. And then Ted Kennedy said, I'd like you to tell this story to the Senate. So I was introduced at the Senate. I was with another guy by the name of Bob Price, and I think he lives in Atlanta. I haven't seen him in 35 years. And we then, I said, I want to talk to Nixon. And he said, well, I can get you as far as the White House. I can't guarantee you talking to Nixon. So whatever, it was the next day, or something like that, I went to the White House. And there was a kid, literally a kid, you know, the 15th aide, you know, had some, and the type of kid that I really didn't like. You know, the one who did everything right in school. He was all dressed up and what have you. But he said, now, tell me what your story is. And I went, you know, I haven't come all this way to talk to you. I need to talk to your superior. And he didn't get any further with me. And so he left the room. And I turned to Bob and I said, well, let's just walk around. We're here. So we walked around. Bob was a very handsome guy, and I was okay at the time. And the secretaries loved having us. So we went from office to office until we got into an office where they were very receptive. And they said, well, let us, you know. And I, to this day, I don't remember if it was Haldeman or Art Ehrlichman's office, but it was one or the other. And a bunch of people were brought in, and we were taken into the office, and they said, what do you have to say for yourself? And we started telling the story. And I looked like a hippie, okay? But Bob Price looked like